Welcome to Brains Matter, a podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. A lot of people have heard about stem cell research. It's been in the media a lot over the past few years, and it's something that's become quite controversial, especially in the US. And here to talk to me about stem cell research and some of her own research is Dr. Orly Lacham-Kaplan. So welcome to the show, Orly.
Thank you.
So firstly, could you tell us what stem cell research is?
Stem cell research, actually, well, let's start, what are stem cells? Stem cells are cells that have the ability to develop into any type of cells that build the tissue. So they have the ability to develop to skin cells, to heart cells, to kidney cells, to literally any type of cells in the body. The origin of stem cells is actually within the embryo. Mm-hmm. When the sperm is fertilizing the egg, we create what we call an embryo, and this entity is starting to divide to two cells and four cells. Then it reaches a stage where it's called a blastocyst, which is like an orange half empty, if we want to call it that way. Mm-hmm. So there is some cells within this structure that have the potential now to develop the real fetus, you know, and in the future when this fetus is implanting in the uterus, then we'll have the development of the organs. All the tissues in the fetus, are originated from those cells, which are very limited in numbers to start with, mm-hmm. but then as the fetus implant, their number is increasing, and then they start to go through a process what we call differentiation to become heart, kidneys, liver, skin, and so on and so on.
So how do these stem cells know what type of cells to
become? Right. There is a continual interaction between the environment and these stem cells. And they actually respond to triggers, to their position, to their timing, and so on and so on. And by this conversation with the stem cells and cells that are not going to become stem cells, they know where to go and what to develop to.
So at what point do stem cells stop appearing in the body? You mentioned they appear in the fetus.
All right, so the early stem cells, or the stem cells that are the original ones, are what we call embryonic stem cells. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, when a tissue is formed, there are still some cells that will not be ultimately final in their differentiation. Mm-hmm. Their cells, we call them the somatic stem cells, which means they are specified cells which are still able to differentiate a little bit more to become final, mm-hmm. but still they have a very nice ability of staying in a state where if there's an injury of the tissue, they will go there and start repairing tissue.
Okay, so an analogy of that would be a draft copy of a paper, so it's not your final paper and you can change it if you need to.
That exactly
is. If you lose your final copy, then you can make that draft copy a complete
one. Absolutely. That's what we have in somatic stem cells, and it is still ongoing to adulthood, which means every tissue in an adult body will have what we call adult stem cells.
Okay.
And these are, as I said before, very much responsible for the repair of the tissue, mm-hmm. following injury. The difference between those two stem cells is really big. Embryonic stem cells have more potential to become any type of the tissue.
So that's like a blank sheet of paper.
Absolutely.
Using an analogy before.
Absolutely. It is something that can develop to whatever we'll tell them to develop to. Mm-hmm. Where in adult stem cells coming from a specific tissue more likely become those type of cells of the tissue. Mm-hmm. Saying that, scientists nowadays developed a method that we call de-differentiation or deprogramming, which means we can take those cells and reverse them back to a state that they will become,
embryo,
in your analysis,
the blank
sheet of paper.
Okay.
Now, those methods that are developed are still quite complicated and not defined as such that we can use them for clinical trials, mm-hmm. because they are using a lot of viruses and so on that are able to take the cell and tell the cell go back to the embryonic state.
And viruses, of course, would be a lot simpler than a human body.
Absolutely. Mm. So, but I believe those methods will be improved, you know, with years, and obviously one day we'll be able to take from a person his own adult stem cells, reverse them back to embryonic stem cells, and probably generate a very much tissues for a specific person or specific patient.
Mm-hmm.
The greatest fear with all the clinical trials that are involved stem cell therapy or stem cell transfer to cure diseases is the rejection.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's very important for us to make sure that the cells that we are using will be a complete match to the patient that will be treated with those cells.
So if you use your own stem cells, obviously it will be 100% match, and
absolutely,
the rejection won't be such an issue.
Absolutely. And that's something that is the main target of stem cell therapy.
Okay. And you were mentioning the embryonic stem cells before. Currently, are the only ones that are like that blank sheet of paper which you can program into any type of tissue. Why is there such a controversy around using embryonic stem cells versus the adult stem cells or somatic stem cells?
Right. Being a reproductive biologist, so starting as a reproductive biologist, I always faced issues that are dealing with embryos, fertility, human fertility. It's very much a very sensitive issue in the point of ethical point of view. You know, people see an embryo not just as a mass of cells, as I see it, which is literally what it is if you look under the microscope. But when you mention the word embryo, people already see hands and legs and heart
and
image, and they think about an entity, a baby. Now, when I'm going to say, look, I'm going to take an embryo and destroy it and retrieve those stem cells for therapy, immediately people are associating it with killing a baby and using those cells for therapy.
The embryos that are used in research, if they weren't used for research, what would happen to them?
Well, most of the embryos nowadays that are used for creating embryonic stem cells are leftovers from IVF clinics, and they usually are left on the bench to die, so they are not
used. So it wouldn't make any difference?
No, they won't make any difference, because if they are not used, they are thrown to the bin.
And in relation to that, I know that when a lot of people have children, they take cord blood. And how does that relate to the embryonic stem
cells? Right.
Right.
One of the other ways that scientists discovered that we're able to use a specific type of stem cells is from the cord blood. Obviously, the earlier you go into the fetal environment or the embryo environment, the better the cells are in terms of inducing repair to tissues and helping with overcoming diseases. Again, a newborn have the umbilical cord, and it contains a lot of good tissues, including the blood, where scientists found out that they can retrieve isolate specific cells, very similar to embryonic stem cells, not as quiet as diverse stem embryonic stem cells, but very close to. And again, those are able to be used for therapies. What we are encouraging people is to bank the cord blood nowadays after the delivery, and this hopefully they won't need to use it in the future, but if God forbid and the child is unwell and needs some form of transplantation, bone marrow transplantation, stem cell therapy transplantation,
he's
got their own stock stores somewhere. So that's one of the things that is really encouraged by us nowadays.
When we talk about stem cells and reproduction, it comes to the question of fertility, and that's an area of research which you look at specifically. So can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing? So I do remember reading about reproduction without the need for a father, which is intriguing. So could you explain a little bit about that and about your research in general?
Sure. I mean, my research is very much related to my own personal background. So I was an embryologist for a long time, and I was a reproductive biologist, and I was researching ways or developing ways to overcome infertility, mainly by men, all right? Infertile men. So I worked a long time in IVF clinics. And the more you work in IVF clinics, you realize the hardship that those people are going through, because they cannot have children. And although it's not something that is obvious on the outside, physically everyone looks normal. It's a very, very strong emotional impair that those people are carrying.
Yeah, absolutely. I have a friend of mine. He was unable to... I'm not sure what the exact cause was, a low sperm count or something like that, but they were very focused on having children. They couldn't, and they had to go through the whole IVF procedure, and it took them 14 years...
Exactly.
...before they could have a child. And that was 14 years of a couple who desperately wanted children who couldn't have children.
Sure. And this couple was very lucky, because some of the couples cannot have that because, unfortunately, the man or the wife cannot produce the gamete that need to create this embryo.
Mm-hmm.
At the time when I was still working in the IVF clinic, I got married and was pregnant with my first girl. During my pregnancy, my husband got sick with lymphoma.
Mm.
On top of it, I had a very, very difficult pregnancy and ended up, unfortunately, that we couldn't have any more children.
Mm.
So now I was sitting on the other side of the whole situation. I was experiencing not being able to have children as a patient. And I was not as lucky as other people that went through the program, and I was not able to conceive. But I have a beautiful little girl. She's not little anymore. She's 16 by now. But, you know, experiencing this heartache, as well as looking at other patients who are unable to have their own biological children, I understood how important it is to give the opportunity for everyone to have their children. So I moved out of the clinic into basic research and purely to develop methods to able couples to reproduce.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the developments were about 2000, where I took a cell from the body and with very specified technology, I influenced or told the cell, look, I wanted to act as a sperm.
Mm-hmm.
And successfully we obtained embryos that developed to a very nice stage in culture. We also transferred those embryos. We got a limited implantation, but I admit that the technique was not successful because we could not get a normal life born from that.
Mm-hmm.
And as a scientist, but more so as a human being with very strong ethical points, I didn't want to say, look, I found a solution for infertility, because it was not true. We found a solution for fertilization, but definitely not to create a normal offspring out of this kind of fertilization. This research is still on hold because my belief is that I still did not find ultimate cell to use for this kind of fertilization.
So this goes back to the earlier discussion of the somatic stem cells and how you can actually program those to act like a sperm cell.
Absolutely. So what I decided is to go exactly for that.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm using a cell from the body to fertilize the egg, why not actually take this cell or any cell and try to develop sperm in culture,
mm-hmm.
and then use it for fertilization? But the question went even further, why not to develop eggs in culture?
Mm-hmm.
And obviously at the time, Professor Alan Transud, who was my mentor, still is, created the Monash Immunology and Stem Cell Laboratories here at Monash University.
Mm-hmm.
And he asked me if I would like to move and explore my ideas with embryonic stem cells. Obviously, I jumped on the opportunity and I arrived here, I think, in 2004.
Mm-hmm.
And brought my research with me, and ever since I am trying to develop eggs and sperm from embryonic stem cells and also from adult stem cells. So
okay.
We're trying to cover all possibilities of stem cells.
Mm-hmm.
The other reason I decided to go for developing eggs in culture is, and that brings us back to the creation of ultimately very much 100% matching embryonic stem cells to the patients it needs.
Mm-hmm.
To do that, we usually use, or we nowadays use the cloning procedure, but we don't like calling it cloning. We're calling it the somatic nuclear transfer procedure. So we take the patient's cells from the skin and we insert it into an empty egg, which we remove the genetic material out from. We create an embryo, and this embryo contains embryonic stem cells, which are a complete match to the patient. And then these embryonic stem cells are developing culture, and we will produce from them whatever we need in order to help the patient recover. Now, to create embryonic stem cells that are specified for a patient, we need a lot of eggs. It's not one or two or three. It's actually sometimes up to 100 eggs for a good success rate to create embryonic stem cell. We don't have so many eggs. The eggs that are coming from donations, or women are willing to donate eggs, are very limited. You know, we have a very limited pool of eggs to be donated for women who required, you know, egg donation, let alone to produce embryonic stem cell. Creating an egg in culture will obviously solve this problem. So we'll have a pool of eggs waiting for us that we can from them use to create embryonic stem cells for most patients who will require that. So that's why, you know, we wanted the eggs as well. And literally that's about it. The egg, the sperm research is very progressive. Not here in Australia. We are able to do that, but unfortunately ethical issues and legal issues in Australia will prevent us from bringing it to the clinic. In England it's very much developed. I know that they are moving forward with changing the law in order to use the sperm that produced in culture to fertilize eggs and see if those embryos are normal. We are not yet able to do that here in Australia, unfortunately. Hopefully, you know, if I'll get my financial support and continue my research, we'll, you know, by the time I'll complete it, the legal arena will change a bit towards supporting this kind of research.
Let's hope so.
The other things that I was very much involved with beside my research in stem cell is I was involved in I was actually awarded last year an award called the Women Achiever Award by BrainLink. And that was given to me because of my input towards overcoming infertility. BrainLink is a great organization that deals with, you know, a holistic approach to treating not the patients but everyone that cares for the patients with brain injury. And they have every year a selection of a woman, because the founder was a woman, and she provided this, you know, core facility called Money Facility to support a woman with achievement in any type of
research.
Not necessarily research to the society. Any woman who has something to do to improve the quality of society will be nominated, and one of them will, you know, be selected each year. I was surprised to be selected as a winner last year, but I work closely with this organization. Meanwhile, also been very much aware of patient advocacy groups, because, again, a sad story from my own family. My niece was 5 years of age when she was diagnosed with leukemia, and we could not find a matching bone marrow for her, and unfortunately she died last August after really a long, terrible, painful year of treatments. And after this death and after being awarded, I thought to myself, I can use my research and I can use my science to a better cause. I can go out there and educate the public. I can go out there and give lectures to students and give lectures to you know, home groups and clubs and rotary clubs and whoever is willing to listen about stem cells and what we can do in order to bring stem cell basic research to clinical trials and hopefully one day a treatment. So I'm trying to found an organization which I met when I was visiting the US recently. They are called Americans for Cures, and all they do is actually advocacy for stem cell therapy. And it doesn't matter what disease, is involved. The roof and the umbrella is stem cell therapy. And I think it's very important to have something like this in Australia. So I'm trying to engage myself with patient advocacy group, explain to them what it is all about, what I would like to do, why it is so important, and so on and so on. I think I will have a lot of hard work, but I think one day it will be
there.
I think so. I think one day it will be there. Yeah, one day we will be able to, you know, change the way of thinking of the public about stem cell therapy. And hopefully it will be sooner than later.
Okay. Well, congratulations on winning the award, and good luck with putting together that group.
Yeah. I just want to mention, and I hope your listeners will listen to that, that we do have, for that reason, we created the Stem Cell Awareness Day, which is an open day on the 25th of September, and it's hosted by our department, the Monash Immunology and Stem Cell Laboratories at Monash University. It will be held here from 9 o'clock to 5 o'clock, and it's open to the public. Anyone who wants to come and listen, they can register through our website and come along and enjoy a very good day of education and science.
It sounds fascinating. So in summary, what we've learned from this discussion is the different types of stem cells. You've got your embryonic stem cells, your somatic stem cells. The somatic stem cells are in the adult patients as opposed to the embryo. Embryonic stem cells can be programmed into any type of cell.
True.
The adult stem cells are almost halfway there, so to speak. That relates to some of your research in fertility, to be able to create eggs and sperm. And if that comes to fruition, hopefully in the not-too-distant future, it will allow infertile couples to be able to have children using their own genetic material. And just quickly, how is that different to the current IVF procedures? What makes that a better
method? IVF procedures are very good for anyone who has eggs and sperm. You cannot do IVF without eggs and sperm.
So for those who cannot produce those type of cells, the stem cell method is the way to go.
Absolutely, it would be the way to go. Unless you are okay with adopting or with egg donation or sperm donation from a donor. Yes, which is a great system, to my opinion. But a lot of people find that they need this completion. Especially you find that people who underwent chemotherapy and radiotherapy and became sterile because of that, they need the ability to reproduce for a complete healing. And it's more emotional, psychological than physical. Yes, I agree. But it is very, very important.
And using that method, you can actually have the same individual producing the egg and the sperm, can't you?
Well, not necessarily. Yes, in theory, but the more we do the research, we realize that female stem cells will probably be better to create eggs, and male stem cell would be better to create sperm. And it might be that things like this we cannot change. It will always be the case, you know. But, you know, theoretically and maybe in the laboratory, yes, the success rate, as I said, is very much related
to
gender as well.
Viability will be lower.
Absolutely. It's very important to follow sometimes the nature events.
All right. Well, Dr. Orly Lacham-Kaplan, thank you very much for your time today.
You're welcome.
It's a fascinating discussion. And if anyone has any questions on that, please email me and I'll get those answers from Dr. Orly for you.
Sure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link, you can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glen Goetz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.